You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Television, Theater, and Film. My name's Naomi Buckley, as you all well know. And today is the last and final broadcast of our session. Today we're going to be talking about directing. And we're going to start off by going through some of the history of directors, how the position of directing evolved over time. And then at the very end, we're going to look at two modern directors and two 21st century directors, and we're going to talk a little bit about them and their style and how modern directing works today. I do want to remind you, of course, that we are live and online. You can give us a call at 1-800-339-1193, and you can type in your question or response at askthtvlive@gmail.com. And that brings me to our question of the day, which is, what are some of the jobs of the director, and do you feel the director is a necessary part of the play production process? So I look forward to hearing some of your thoughts. And this is your very last chance to get extra credit, so I encourage you to type in today and get your last bit of extra credit before we start calculating those grades. Before we get into some of the history of directing throughout the ages, I do want to do a little tiny bit of housekeeping. So I just want to remind you that this is our last broadcast, and this is the week in which you need to be taking your final exam. The final exam was open on Tuesday, and it is available to you until Sunday at midnight. So that's May 14th until midnight. It is a timed exam. You cannot take it multiple times, just like the midterm. Obviously, it's open book, but because it's timed, I would encourage you to be familiar with the chapters that are listed. It's pretty much, it's cumulative, so anything that we've gone over during the course of the semester could be in your final exam. Also, you have one last discussion board due this week, so don't forget to do that, as I'm sure many of you have come to realize that is missing only one or two of those discussion boards can really take your grade down, and there's really no reason for that to happen. They're so easy to do, and they require really not that much effort, so please make sure you go in and take care of your final discussion board. And that brings me to the last announcement for today, and that is that once the 14th comes, guys, once this Sunday comes, that is the last chance to turn in anything. So if you still have outstanding work due, or you have maybe some discussion boards that you didn't do, the first thing you need to do is contact me and let me know and see if I might be willing to allow you to turn some of those in late. You're going to miss points because it is late, but sometimes some points is better than no points for some of us, right? So contact me first and see. And also, if you know what you're missing, it's very, very helpful to me if you can tell me exactly what you're missing. Don't just say, I'm missing some discussion boards, or there's a quiz that I didn't take that I really would like to be able to take. Please don't be general. There's a lot of you in the class, and there are a lot of quizzes, and there's a lot of discussion boards. So rather than making me take a bunch of time to try and figure out what it is that you need to make up, if you can tell me what it is that you need to do specifically, then I can let you know which one of those you can do and what sort of points you'll be looking at if at least you do them late, okay? So that would be the first thing. And then secondly, everything is gonna be due on Sunday. So I'm just letting you know now, today is Thursday. That really gives you only 4 days. If you're even thinking about it, make sure that you contact me ASAP and let me know what you're missing. You need to contact me via email. Please don't type in today. Please don't call and ask. Just give me an email, send me an email, and we'll try and figure out how we can help you. We want everyone to hopefully pass the class, right? Okay, so that's it. That's all I'm gonna talk about. I'll give you another little reminder at the end of class before we're done, but let's move on. So again, Our question of the day today is, what are some of the jobs of the director, and do you feel the director is a necessary part of the play production process? We actually already have somebody who's typed in, so let's start off with somebody's comment. Katrina says, the director must take on so many jobs through the process of a play. Some of them include choosing a script, choosing the style of the production, and casting all of the actors. Yes. I like that you recognize that they have to take on so many jobs. Director is really a jack of all trades. They're someone that does a little bit of everything, and because of that, they have to know a little bit of everything in order to do the job correctly. And as we get further along in our discussion today, you're gonna get a real taste of what all that everything is that we're talking about and what Katrina is referring to here as well. Well, let's take a little trip back in time, as we usually do at this point in our broadcast, and let's talk about directors before the 19th century. So this is going all the way back to Greek and Roman theater. And guys in the Greek and Roman theater, and pretty much throughout all of history until about the 18th century, 17th century, there was no such thing as a director as we know it today. The director is a modern invention. It is something, it is a position in the production of a play that is relatively new, especially the way we understand the director's role today. But before that, what were some of the things that we had? Well, in the ancient Greek time, we had something called the chorus. And the chorus was the person who was the head of the chorus. If you remember, the chorus was usually a group of people that spoke. They had lines. Sometimes their lines were sung. Sometimes they chanted the lines. But there were a group of people, and their lines represented common sense or the everyman's voice. And the chorus was the head of the chorus, and this is the person who often directed or coordinated the song and movement portion for the chorus, right? Because there were multiple people there. So we do know that that person did that job. The playwrights, as was the case for many, many hundreds of years, going all the way through Shakespeare's time, usually probably staged the play. So that means the playwright was the one that probably said to people, here's where you should come in and from where, and here's where you should exit. But as far as we know, again, even until Shakespeare's time, that was really the extent of the playwright's job. They might try to help you to understand the text, but really their job was just, hey, you're going to enter in from stage left, and then you're going to exit stage right. It wasn't come and stand here and then move there, and you know, the complicated kind of compositional work that directors do today. And we also, we don't know enough about what the role of the playwright was in the Greek and Roman time, but we don't think that they played a unifying role. They may have, we really don't know enough, but we don't think, again, that they played that kind of unifying role that the modern director does. In Roman times, it was usually a wealthy organizer, someone who had paid for a patron of the playwright or whoever was putting up the show that organized it. But again, we don't know what kind of unifying effect they played on the play production. They may have organized certain aspects, but we don't know that they were necessarily unifying the concept or vision of the piece. In the medieval era, we had several people that had kind of organizational and managerial roles that were really important to making sure that these plays went off without a hitch. One of them was called, I love this, the Master of Secrets, right? And this was the person who was in charge, I'll just say guy because it was probably a guy because there were no women in the theater at the time. This person was in charge of the special effects, and they were an expert in it. And there were a lot of special effects, if you remember us talking about that kind of medieval plays, you know, there was smoke and explosions and guts coming out sometimes. So there were a lot of effects, and these were kept actually really, really secret because they wanted people, like magic, they wanted people to be kind of surprised and the spectacle of it to continue. And so that's why they were called the Master of Secrets. And these kinds of special effects that they did were really closely held secrets, and they were usually passed on from father to son. And this was kind of a very familial job that would be taken, as many things were at this time. Also, there was the keeper of the register, and the register, the word register refers to a master copy of the script. So there was someone who was in charge of keeping a master copy of the script and making sure that it was up to date and that there were copies of it, and that those copies or prompt scripts would go out to the actors and then they would be collected at the end. And there were also guilds, and this is usually a group of craftsmen who could hold on to the register. And meaning the play, right? And then they could pass that on from generation to generation. Also, the guilds would be responsible for creating, different guilds would be responsible for creating different things. There would be costuming guilds and like set guilds and all kinds of things. So these guilds would work in unison. They had their specialties, but they worked in unison, and they were kind of like the generational keeper of the scripts as well. Well, with the rise of professional acting groups, basically right towards the end of Shakespeare's career and afterwards, we get the development of something that's called the actor manager, right? And this is somebody who is an actor, usually a senior actor in the company, someone who's been around the longest, who's done all the roles and usually lead roles, knows a lot about the world of the theater. And they would also become the company's manager. And so this meant that they were in charge. They were in charge of helping to pick what plays the company would do, where they would go. They would manage the company's finances. And we believe also that they did a lot of some of the directorial roles, like blocking the play. And again, some of the managerial things, like deciding what they were going to do, keeping copies of the script, distributing, training actors, and all of these things. One of the people that we know did this, we actually have records that we know that this guy functioned in this way, was Molière. You might remember him. We talked about him some time ago when we were talking about 17th century theater and French neoclassicism. And he's a very, very well-known playwright from the 17th century in France, and many would argue kind of up there with Shakespeare in terms of his writing and the things that he did and the accomplishments that he has. He was definitely an actor manager. He managed the troupe that he was a part of. He would hire and fire actors. He trained other younger actors. He wrote the plays. He helped to direct the plays in the sense that he would call to rehearsals and he would tell actors when to come in and when to go out and kind of coach them. So he was taking on a great deal of kind of like those responsibilities that we begin to see forming the basis of what we consider a modern director's role, right? And he was an actor, a producer. He acted in his own films. In fact, he died shortly after appearing on the stage. He had tuberculosis. But even in all the years that he was ill, he kept performing. And in fact, he performed one evening and went home and died several hours later because he was so ill. But very dedicated to the theater and to his own company. As I said, also a writer and directed, not in maybe the modern sense, but in the time, doing a lot of those functions that we would consider part of a director's role. Another person that kind of follows along moving forward into the 18th century and is developing this kind of idea of what a modern director is David Garrick. David Garrick is from London. He was an English actor manager. And he was the manager of Drury Lane Theatre. Drury Lane Theatre, which is still there today in London in the West End. You can go and visit it. And he was the manager there from 1747 to 1776. 1776, you might recognize that date as the year that America gained its independence from the United Kingdom. So he was there during that time. And he was known to be very strict with his actors. We're kind of where we see here the beginning of the idea of what a modern director should be is really beginning to develop. And we see this really with a couple of these directors that are kind of coexisting at the same time, and definitely David Garrick. He had a very strict rehearsal schedule, which was unusual, right? I mean, well, it was unusual for the time. It was usually actors would just be called in maybe a few days to be given entrances and exits and to be told where to stand and where to go off, and maybe a little coaching on the script, but that would be it. But David Garrick was very, very strict with his actors. He had actually what at the time would be considered a lengthy rehearsal process. He wanted to make sure that actors really knew their lines. He was a very big stickler for people knowing their lines and reciting them appropriately. He even had a book of conduct that he had all of his actors that were in his company had to read and sign. And that's very interesting because this is also a time in which actors, their real life personalities, who they are as people, and their onstage personalities are kind of mixed in a way. If you think about it, this is a time also where actors are starting to gain real celebrity. People are becoming really big stars, kind of like what we have now. But what there wasn't that we have now is this separation between the everyman and these really big stars. So if you imagine, you know, living in London, which was a big city for the time, but not nearly anything compared to what we have today, you might actually be out and about and see David Garrick or another very famous star. And you might have interactions with them on a daily basis. So that separation wasn't there. You know, they didn't have bodyguards and all these things keeping them away from people. So they were very much a part of, you know, still living these very kind of everyday lives. And oftentimes their personas and the reputation that they would form outside would be taken onto the stage. And David Garrick actually didn't like that. He didn't like that there wasn't this separation between an actor's real life persona and their stage persona. And part of what his Book of Conduct was about was making sure that those two things stayed separate, that these actors, he was trying also to gain respectability for actors, because at the time, again, this was not a very respectable profession to go in. If you remember, God, up until the 19th century, actors couldn't even be buried in the same, you know, cemetery, a church cemetery. They had to be buried outside of the church cemetery, which meant to people at the time that were very religious that when, you know, Christ comes back and he raises everybody up from the dead, you're not going to get raised up because you're not buried in sacred ground, right? So, I mean, this is kind of how terrible it was that the acting was seen in this way. And David Garrick, part of his Book of Conduct, was trying to kind of change the tide of the way actors were seen. He wanted his actors to be respectable, considered respectable people outside and inside of the theater. So he also had a lot of innovations that he brought to the theater. And one of them was removing audience from the stage. Now, that might seem weird to you. Audience on the stage? Why would there be audience on the stage? Well, up until this time, it had been common practice for any aristocrat or well-heeled person to be sat on the stage upon request or as an honor, because they were aristocrats, or maybe they helped to pay for the show in some way. They were patrons in some way, or they were just well-known, or they were a duke or a lord or something. It would be very common practice to seat those aristocrats or well-heeled people on the stage with the actress. And it could be very distracting. Not only that, if you imagine you're seeing audience people sat on the stage, maybe sometimes not paying attention to the show, that kind of distracts from your experience. So Garrick made a really hard line rule that nobody could be sat on the stage, even those people that were patrons. Everybody had to sit on the audience and in the audience. And you can see that this is a step towards realism that he's taking here. This is a step towards that really clear definition between audience and performers and that fourth wall that we're starting to create. He also demanded what at the time would have been considered a very natural style of acting from his actors. Now, if we saw it, we'd probably think it was very stilted and over the top and theatrical. But at the time, he was, again, trying to push for something that he felt was closer to real life. And he also brought a focus on scene design and the importance of scene design to his plays. He felt that that was an important aspect. It shouldn't be secondary. And there was real time and money put into making sure that the scenic design was done well. And again, here we start to see these kind of foundations of the modern director and the things that modern directors to this day do. In his own time, he was considered what we would think of as a director, but in England, they actually don't call what we call directors directors, they call them producers. And that's actually the term that's used even today, even though that's a word that we use to mean something completely different. Another person in Germany that was kind of forging the way for the modern director was Johann Wolfgang von Goethe. And he was another really important force in Europe for kind of developing and creating this idea of what a director does and what the roles are of a director. He was part of the whole Weimar Classicism movement, which was a movement in Germany to return to some of these kind of classic ideals of the theater, art, and music. And Goethe was not just a theater practitioner. He was also a writer. You may have heard his name in that respect, a philosopher, and he did a lot of other things. But he is also very well known for his work in developing this idea of kind of like the single unifier on the stage and the role of the director. He was very strict. Again, he was another one of these people who, like Garrick, had very strict rehearsal schedules and he had a dress code for his actors when they came in and when they were not there. And he would have this lengthy rehearsal process for the time. And he also mistrusted others' talent. He was very hard on people. He didn't, he was known to be very, very hard on and demand a lot from his actors. Again, we see this kind of development into modern directing today. Finally, one of the most important people in this line of pre-20th century directors is a gentleman named the Duke of Saxon-Meiningen. And the Duke of Saxon-Meiningen is really, by many, many people, considered the first modern director. He is the gentleman who kind of takes all these things that all these other directors are doing in bits and pieces, and he puts them together, and he makes it the job of one person to do all of them. He had a touring group that he toured throughout Europe from 1870 to 1890, and he was fond of doing historical plays. Sometimes he'd do his own adaptations of these historical plays. He was very, very focused on realism and being very realistic, realistic sets and realistic costumes and realistic props. And he had a lot of money because he was an aristocrat. And he would commission these, you know, tailors to sew these costumes that would be historically accurate for the time period. And they would do this research on what these costumes would look like. Now, nowadays, that maybe doesn't seem like that big a deal. Of course, if you're going to do something in the Roman times, you wear the things that the Romans wear. If you're going to do something in, you know, the Elizabethan times, you put clothes on the actors that look like that. But that was not the case up until this point. Even when we're looking at some of these other directors like Molière for certain, David Garrick for certain, the clothes that the actors wore were their own clothes, 99% of the time. Actors would oftentimes work for wealthy patrons like lords or dukes or ladies doing different things during different shows. And in the process of working for those people, they'd get stipends. And in those stipends was always allotted a certain amount of money for clothing. And they would usually have, every so many years, just a really beautiful gown or a beautiful suit made for them that was their kind of stage attire. But it was made in the style of the clothes at the time. And it was obviously, I mean, very beautiful. It was intended as a very expensive piece of clothes, something that you wouldn't just walk around the house in. So it's special, but it certainly wasn't, if you're playing Ophelia in Shakespeare, you know, you're not going to wear a dress that maybe Ophelia would have worn. You're just going to wear this dress that you always wear when you're on the stage. And there might be bits and pieces that actors would put on to kind of indicate some kind of historical thing. If you're doing a Roman play, maybe you put on, you know, some kind of swag of fabric around, or maybe you wear a hat or a wreath in your hair or something. But for the most part, actors were wearing their own clothes and they were in the style of dress of the time. So up until this point, up until the Duke of Saxon-Meiningen, this idea that actors should wear clothes that were historically accurate to the time of whatever it is that they're performing in was really actually wild and kind of crazy. And he was able to do it because he had the money to fund these for the actors. The actors weren't having to buy their own costumes. He was funding it for them. Also, the sets were, you know, designed in such a way to look historically accurate to the time, not just to be beautiful. Remember, there were a lot of stock sets that were used at this time. Oh, you're supposed to be in a room in the castle? Here's the standard room in the castle look. Oh, you're supposed to be in a bedroom? Here's the standard bedroom look that we have, right? So Meiningen was very, very concerned with making sure that everything looked accurate. If you're supposed to be outside, then we're going to have an area that looks outside. If you're supposed to be inside, then we're going to have an area that looks specific to whatever the interior is of this particular show that we're doing. Some of the other things that he's really well known for, and these are things that are really important in terms of the development of the modern director today, is that he used a pictorial style. And this is a style that's used even today. A lot of time is spent, when you learn directing, focusing on how do we create composition and focus on the stage. And so what this means is that as a director, you're looking at where actors are on the stage, and you're using those positions and those places that you put them in to create pictures, nice pictures, right? Not only that, you're using those pictures to tell the audience where they should be looking. Where's the most important thing that's happening on the stage right now? Who's the most important person, right? And so this is, you know, very similar to what painters do when they paint something and they think about where the object's going to be, what's a pleasing way to put these objects here, what's a way to put objects here in a way that maybe communicates something symbolic or metaphorical. And directors are thinking in that same way. But this was the first time that that style had ever really been used. And it was the Duke of Saxe-Meiningen that really forged this style and brought this onto the stage. In fact, so much so that he was very, very well known for his large crowd scenes because he was such a master of composition. And they were so beautifully composed that people just loved to look at these scenes where he would sometimes have 20 or 30 people on stage at the same time and yet have this really, really well-composed scene. So he is the guy, again, that we consider the first real modern director, and he brings in a lot of things that many, many other people begin to use and generates new ground for everybody. All right, well, before we move on to 20th century directors, I want to go ahead and read. I know that we have some more people typing in here to our question of the day. Our question of the day, which is, what are some of the jobs of the director? And do you feel that the director is a necessary part of the play production process? And Mason says, some of the jobs of the director is to oversee the production of a play and make sure that everything is complete in a play and to direct people. The director is an extremely necessary part of a play production process because without a director, it would be much harder to create and put on a play, and a play and the play production of it would not be complete without the director. Good, right. So nowadays, we think of the director as being like an indispensable part of like play production, and really primarily that's because the actors themselves, the skills that are needed to kind of organize and put together the play production process are no longer taught to actors. And the way that actors function today, there are no more companies where actors can learn these skills. And so, yes, in the way that theater and acting has developed over the years, the director has become really an indispensable part of the world of the theater. Caitlin says, absolutely, the director is definitely a necessary part of the playing process because he or she is in charge of so much. The director oversees the entire play, making sure that everything goes smoothly. Some of the jobs of the director include working closely with the actors and designers, choosing a script, and finding a spine for the play. Oh, I love that you use that word, Caitlin. Yes, the spine of the play. What does that mean? That means, well, what is the main message of the play? What is the main theme of the play? And how is the director going to translate that into a directorial concept or some kind of a vision for the piece and bring that unifying force to it? We're going to talk more about it later so maybe you get a better understanding, but I love that you brought that up. A very important job that the director has. Sage says, the director has many jobs, mainly focusing on everything, getting the correct proportion and good order in production, making sure the story is well made and makes sense, and the idea everyone should have when making the set. The director is like the brains of the operation. They can't do it by themselves, but they are there to make sure everything is on track and no one gets lost. If you look at the credits at the end of the movies, it takes like a good 5 to 10 minutes sometimes to get through all those names. The director has to make sure all of it went according to plan, assigning the right captains, leaders to a group of people to get certain things done. Yes, you know, in some ways, the director is actually even more important in film than they are in the world of the theater. In fact, many people would say that, you know, in the world of film, the director is key, the director is God, right? The director can have kind of as much or as little power as they want to have, but they certainly are the ones that are there kind of, we'll talk about that a little bit, in kind of sometimes really creating the entire feel of the piece. But the stage is not exempt from that, and it's really important that the director be there to kind of unify whatever, like, you know, Caitlin was saying, the kind of spine of the play, the kind of idea that's going to be the main metaphor of the piece, right? All right, so let's move on to 20th century directors. So now we're into kind of like the creation, the final like encapsulation of everything that we understand today as being the modern director. And At this point, directing as we know it today was still in its infancy, so there was still a lot of growing that people had to do, but certainly this was now a new position. People were doing plays, and there was a position called the director, and that director was usually not an actor in the play and not someone who was doing another job. That was the specific job of this one person to kind of do all of these things, right? So that is a real kind of, that's where the leap forward comes. Just like the Duke of Saxe-Meiningen, again, he was not an actor in the play. It was his specific role to kind of direct, organize, and unify these productions in the way that he saw fit. And that's what we're going to see moving forward through the 20th century. So we're going to kind of touch all around Europe as we look at some of the important kind of modern directors throughout the 20th century. And the first one we're going to start with France. We're going to start with a name that we've mentioned before here in class called Andrei Antonin. And Andrei Antonin, again, was a gentleman with really wild ideas. He started a kind of movement and style of theater called the Theater of Cruelty. He was alive from 1858 to 1943, and he was the manager and director of everything that took place in the Theater Libre, and which means the Theater of Liberty, right? And he was a very, a unifying force. He was writing the plays that these people produced. He had a real direct vision for what he wanted to see on the stage. He was casting the actors. He was coordinating the rehearsals and the costumes and everything. And he is a part of this whole big chain of people that are starting to really fill out what it means to be a modern director during this time. Otto Braun in Germany, who was the manager and director of the Free Stage in Germany called the Freie Bühne, which, again, a similar feeling to what Antonin was doing in France. There were a lot of these kinds of theaters at the beginning of the 20th century that were kind of really pushing the boundaries. And these really strong directors with really strong visions were coming in, and they were saying, theater doesn't have to be this one way or that one way. It can be all of these different things. And remember, these were all these kind of competing ideas that were kind of the backlash against realism as realism was gaining traction and becoming kind of like the dominant force in theater. J.T. Guin was in London, and he was kind of like this similar force there. He was a director there at the Independent Theater in London from 1862 to 1938. And then, of course, last but certainly not least, we can't forget Konstantin Stanislavski, who was the director of the Moscow Art Theater. And along with Vladimir Nemirovich Dachenko, they were co-founders of the Moscow Art Theater, and they were directors. Now, Stanislavski was also an actor, but that was really only at the beginning of the founding of the theater. Eventually, he became solely a director and a practitioner and theorist. And he was the driving force behind the Moscow Art Theater. And, he was there working with Chekhov and putting these plays together and creating the whole vision. And in so many ways, because of that, he is one of the primary foundational kind of practitioners that forms what we all consider to be realism today in the style of realism. Not only that, but the actor's approach to realism and the director's approach to realistic styles of theater. So he was a really important person in creating not only the role of the modern director, but how the modern director operates in the style of realism. Other names that we're going to mention, but I'm not going to talk too much about, but they're important 20th century directors, are Edward Gordon Craig. We talked about him last time in terms of the Child's Restaurant set that he commissioned. Vsevolod Meyerhold, we talked about him and his kind of like crazy sets and all the things that he was doing. David Belasco, Max Reinhardt, Tyrone Guthrie, and Ilya Kazan. Ilya Kazan was the director, the manager and director of all the plays at the Group Theater in New York in the 1930s. He served as a mentor, he served as a critic, he served as a kind of therapist for actors, and he was a really big force in theater in the 30s and all the way throughout until quite recently when he, relatively recently, where he passed away. And he was a big proponent of Stanislavski's technique and psychological realism. There was an interesting controversy concerning Ilya Kazan that you might be interested in some time ago. I mean, it's a while ago now, but in 1999, he received the Lifetime Achievement Award at the the Oscars, and there was a huge controversy about it because in the 50s, Elia Kazan had actually been called to the HWAC commission, if you remember, with McCarthyism, the committee of, you know, the House Committee on Un-American Activities, and he had actually named names and he had turned in some of his colleagues saying that they were communists. So it was kind of a mixed bag with Mr. Elia Kazan. Another person I'm going to mention just a bit out of all these names is Vsevolod Meyerhold. I know we talked about him and we talked about his kind of constructivist sets. Sorry. But one of the other things about Meyerhold, aside from his really unique approach, abstract, very physically generated approach to the theater, was that he was considered a very strict and dictatorial director. And in fact, it was his style of directing, this kind of dictatorial style, that kind of got us the name of directors. That, you know, they're kind of like, hopefully they're not, but, you know, that they're kind of like these dictators that are like the bosses. They're the brains of the operation. They're the ones kind of telling everyone else what to do. All right, well, what happened after World War II? Right now we get the directors, the modern directors, moving out of its infancy into its adolescence, and we get something called the auteur director, which is still with us today. The role of the director begins to change. It's not just somebody who's there kind of like directing everything and managing everything and making sure that everything goes smoothly. Now we see these directors that are not only just about making sure that everything goes off smoothly, but they have a really, really specific viewpoint, and they're aiming to communicate that viewpoint and that worldview through the things that they direct and in the way in which they direct them. The literal definition is someone who brings their own thoughts and feelings to the film or play and also imbues it with their own worldview. And it's someone who has a really specific style, a voice, a specific viewpoint. And there are so many people that still fit this type or style of directing. And I'm going to name primarily film people, since that's who you're going to be most familiar with. But Spielberg is one of those people. If you watch a Spielberg film, you know it's a Spielberg film. There are certain filming techniques that he uses and ways that he goes about doing things. His voice and his style is very clear throughout all of his work. Another one is Terrence Malick. If you've ever seen a Terrence Malick film, The Thin Red Line, New World, Tree of Life, all these things, it's like you could turn that on, and if you're familiar with Terrence Malick's work, you don't even need someone to tell you that it's Terrence Malick. You would know that this is something that he's done because it's so specific in his style, it's so specific in his viewpoint, that you know that that's who that is. And also Wes Anderson. This is you could have the sound off and no one could tell you that that's a Wes Anderson film and you would know, because his style is so specific, from everything to the types of actors, to the costumes, to the makeup, to the language itself, but even just visually, the style that you see there, that is the hallmark of a true auteur director. Some of the people that fill this role out after World War II in the world of theater are Jerzy Grotowski, Peter Brook, and Richard Schechner. And these are three directors that you may not be familiar with, but they did a lot of important work after in the 1950s, after that point in the 60s and the 70s and into the 80s and even into the 90s. Jerzy Grotowski was a protege of not only Stanislavski, but others, and he trained under them. He's a Polish director. And he really kind of, he felt that he continued Stanislavski's work in terms of where Stanislavski was going with his technique towards the end of his career. And where he thought Stanislavski was going, which I think a lot of people would agree, is towards a more physical approach to theater. Grotowski even coined his own term for what he thought this style of theater should be, and he called it a poor theater, theater of the poor, poor theater. And what he meant by that wasn't that it should be like no sets necessarily or no costumes or that it shouldn't have these things, although in some ways he did mean that. But what he really meant was that acting in the theater should be about the essential things. It should be about the base things that make us human, those things that are so universal that they touch everybody in a really kind of deep and profound way. And the actors should be concerned with getting at those things not in thinking too much and intellectualizing too much, but in sort of experiencing and moving through the work in a very universal way that gets to the heart of whatever the text is about. And because of this, he would take texts and he would completely redo them and adapt them. One of the things that he did was he took this idea of Greek theater and Greek plays, and he did a play called Acropolis, which was something that they devised, him and his theater company devised together, and he and his actors. And it is a very physical piece. A lot of his works are very physical. It's very immersive in lots of ways, and it's very spare, but very, very powerful. And Grotowski was known for kind of taking audiences and putting them in unique situations and kind of out-of-the-box surroundings to kind of take them out of their expectations and get them to participate in a way maybe that they wouldn't before. So if you see the picture behind me, this is actually a picture from one of the performances of Acropolis. And it was, again, this kind of meditation on a Greek theater and the epics and the tragedy and the gods and all that stuff, and this kind of different way of exploring it for the actors. He also did an adaptation of Faustus, in which the original production had all of the audience sat at these two enormously long, like 20-foot tables. That's where the audience sat. And the whole entire play was as though the audience members were guests at this dinner where the play of Faustus was going to be taking place. So you can see this kind of immersive quality that he had, and very, very physical and very spare. The space between the two tables becomes a river in which Mephistopheles' head gets dunked into the river by his wife. You know, so this kind of transformative space, actors are climbing on top of the tables and walking around. They become pathways at some point. So this kind of use of the imagination and the basics of the theater to create really, really powerful work that kind of gets at to the heart of things and isn't so concerned with the complexity of language always. All right. Another really important auteur director from the time is Peter Brook. Peter Brook was an English director. And he did some really wonderful things. One of the things that he is well known for is his production of Murat Saad, which we saw the film version of it a few weeks ago, but also his kind of reinterpretation of Midsummer Night's Dream. And this is just like such a wild reinterpretation of the play. We'll pull a picture up in a second. It was done in this kind of unit set that was white with people like, you know, suspended from, you can kind of see like ropes and rigging, and they could fly around the space. The whole set is white except for these pops of color that come out either through these like feather-like clouds that are suspended in places or the actors themselves. And it was this just kind of crazy, wild reinterpretation of the piece that was really wonderful and beautiful, and actually brought the piece to life in a way that, you know, maybe it hadn't been before. And it was one of those things where either you loved it or you hated it, but it was really, really wild. And as you can see, a really specific point of view that's being presented here. This might be something that's been done a million times, but when Peter Brook does it, it's going to be a Peter Brook production, right? Another thing that he did for several years and that went toured for many years and then eventually was made into a film was the Mahabharata. And the Mahabharata is based on an Indian text of the same name. It's a spiritual text. And here you can see an image of the play. You can actually watch the film online too. The play was 9 hours long. The play was nine hours long. People would come and watch the play until the evening, and then they would come back and they would watch the play again for two nights in a row. And it was just incredibly epic and beautiful. And again, kind of one of those things where you either loved it or you hated it. Again, eventually made into a film. And, you know, some people really adored it and some people didn't, but it was definitely Peter Brook's take on this whole thing. And it took him many, many years to develop it And then, you know, he toured it for many years, and then he did the film. There's actually a wonderful kind of little a description of what the original piece was like when it was first performed in the New York Times. It was first performed in France at the Théâtre du Nord, and there is a description of what it was like to kind of attend this show. And so I want to read it to you because I think it gives you a sense of what it would have been like to go to Peter Brook's Mahabharata in Avignon. So, the New York Times says, in Avignon, Mr. Brook's theater was an open limestone quarry outside the city where spectators sat on scaffolding facing massive boulders, rose-tinted cliffs 100 feet high, and a vast playing space filled with tons of luminous yellow sand. So, okay, you're going to see a theater show, but first you have to go out into the middle of nowhere outside of the city, and the stage, which isn't a stage, it's not even inside, is in a limestone quarry, and your seats are on scaffolding. So if you know what scaffolding is, it's that stuff they put around buildings with the, you know, big pieces of wood and the poles, and that's what you sit on. So, you know, three or four, you know, levels high. You sit on the scaffolding with, you know, I don't know how many people could fit on there. And you look at the theater, which is looking towards these cliffs and this big sandy area, right? So first of all, you know you're in for something completely different. There was a canal of real water constructed by the technical director, Jean Guillicot. It flowed across the back of the space. A small pond reflecting the action was down front. So there's a real canal, like a stream of water that's against the back of the cliffs, and then a pond of water in front of the playing space that actually you can see the action in. That these are created spaces that were made to be in the space, right? At one side was an altar-like arrangement of low burning flames and Indian garlands. At the other, the percussion, string, and wind instruments for the musicians who each night improvised the music and became an integral part of the action. When it grew dark, the lighting transformed the rocks, water, sand, and cliffs to gold yellow, deep beige, and slate blue, so that the terrain appeared as a unifying image in a dream expressing the enigmatic, primitive beauty of the elements. So, you can imagine that going to see this show was transforming, unique, to say the least. And really, who else would do something like that? Nobody but Peter Brook. So, a unique perspective that this director is bringing in to present the piece that's told in a very unique voice as well. All right, we're going to read a few more of these responses to our question of the day, and then we'll take a break. And when we come back, we'll talk about some of the roles, skills, and duties that the modern director has. But first, let's read a couple of these. Jacqueline says, in response to our question of the day, the main role of a director is to, of course, direct. He or she has the job of unifying the visions of the actors as well as the writers. They are also tasked with making sure everyone works to the best of their ability to put on the greatest possible performance. The director is there to get the best out of everybody, that's for sure. Whether it be their designers or whether it be their actors or whether it be their stage manager, they're there to try to get the best out of everybody. And every director has a different way of doing that. Brandon says, the director manages many aspects of a production. He or she is like the CEO of a play because of all the decisions he or she has to make in order to be true to the vision or main action that is to be portrayed. The director also has to choose how to present the play in naturalism, allegorical, or an expressionistic manner. Sorry, Brandon. Yes, absolutely. Some of that is dictated by the script, right? If I, you know, for instance, when I did Mach and All, that's an expressionistic piece. You would be remiss to not do it in the style that the playwright wrote it in. But it's true that, you know, certain things, we do have a choice. We can be more naturalistic or less naturalistic, and we can choose the varying degrees of that. That's the beauty of modern theater, is that we have all of these colors to play with now, and we get to decide which ones we want to play with. We're not hemmed in like we used to be. And that can be exhilarating, and it can also be debilitating because you do have so many choices. All right, well, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to finish up by talking about some of the modern director's roles, the responsibilities, what it takes to be a director. And then we're going to look at some modern directors, and we're going to kind of compare their two styles and talk a little bit about what each of these two people, how their role fits into the modern theater. All right, so I'll see you back here in 5 minutes.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, my name is Obi Wogboy, and I'm currently a junior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. The reason I came to this school is for the great environment, the small class sizes, and the amazing sociology program.
Many of our brothers feel like they're a part of a family, whether it's the culture, color of the skin, or just being comfortable with other men. The bond keeps growing, and the brotherhood keeps strengthening itself through those means. The Male Success Alliance at Cal State Dominguez Hills is creating a genuine brotherhood.
It does not force you to be anything. It does not require you to be a certain type of student.
We're here emotionally, physically, and anytime a brother needs anything, we're going to be there.
A lot of times, men of color aren't seen as professional, or you don't even see them in professional settings. So the Male Success Alliance is trying to get our men ready within their undergrad to be in that professional setting because they are the professional. The manner that the program is doing this is through the concentration of being there for our brothers. The practical way of doing that is, you know, redefining and strengthening the brotherhood, you know, within the campus and through the workshops and different events that we have. The suit is that signal that we're trying to create. You know, that whole changing the narrative is coming through the suit. When a man's able to be clean, they feel good. It gives us confidence and it oozes out of the guys.
Watching Dr. Franklin, Matt Smith, you know, walk around in these nice suits, it's like, hey, I want to be like that. I want to be him one day. I want to be able to wear that nice suit.
And you see it the results are better academics, more social, better social life. And a lot of guys just want to be a part of the program because of it.
The Male Success Alliance found me in a very interesting time place, trying to balance classes and my home life. I started to really fail in many ways. I found MSA on my verge of not being a student anymore. Meeting the actual student body president of the Male Success Alliance, I met him and it was like, nah, brother, you are my brother, and anything you need from me, just let me know.
And that's what MSA is built on. How does each one teach one, and how do we bring our brothers along with us? And that's why MSA sets that legacy in terms of, it's not just about CSU Dominguez Hills, it's this region, it's this state, and it's the nation, and these young men are going to change all of them.
My name is Alex Guerrero, and I'm a Toro.
My name is James Harris, and I'm a Toro.
I'm Jordan Sylvester, and I'm a Toro.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Theater 100. Today we're talking about directing, and we've talked a little bit now about the history of directing, moving all the way up through the 20th century. And we're going to talk a little bit now about what are some of the roles and things that the skills that a director needs in order to do their job. Before, of course, we get into that, I want to remind you, as you can see on the bottom of the screen there, we are live and online. You can give us a call at 1-800-339-1193. You can type in at askdhtvlive@gmail.com, and just to remind you, our question of the day is, what are some of the jobs of the director, and do you feel the director is a necessary part of the play production process? So I look forward to maybe hearing from just a few more of you before we finish up for today. So, obviously, over many centuries, the role of the modern director has been continually redefined, it's been shaped, it's been sculpted into what it is today. So what does the modern director do? What are some of the things? We've talked about some of them here, but let's get specific. One of the first things that a director, of course, does may be choosing the script, just depending. Sometimes you get to choose the script, sometimes you don't. Just depends on where you are and where you're directing. Sometimes directors are brought in to direct something that's already been decided. They may or may not be crazy about it, but they have to direct it. But whether or not they get to decide on the script, they certainly do, as the last person was saying here, get to decide on the interpretation of the script. How are they going to interpret that script? There are many themes that are possible, many possible interpretations of a script. Some of them right, some of them wrong. Hopefully the director picks one that is correct. And then they choose to focus on that interpretation. And that's what we call kind of like, what's the unifying vision for the piece? What's the thing that the director is going to focus on as the main concept for this play? They also cast the actors. They decide who's going to be put in which parts. And that's a very important process, because picking the right actors for a show is kind of one of those first steps that might not seem that important, but ultimately is. And it can really decide the success or failure of a particular show, especially when we're looking at maybe parts that are very complicated, difficult, hard to communicate. It's really important that we either find people that kind of naturally fit into those roles or that have the talent to portray these particular characters. And also looking for actors that have chemistry with each other. Sometimes maybe you've heard of that. Sometimes there are people that when you put them together, maybe they've never met before in their life, but they have a really good energy together. They kind of click, right? And there are some parts where you need that. There are some parts where you need actors to not click, that you need them to have kind of an adversarial relationship with one another. So a director is looking at all of those things. They're looking at, how do these people get along together? How don't they? And many directors are running these auditions with people that maybe they've never met before. They've never seen these people before in their lives. They don't know. They know what maybe their work history is, because an actor brings a resume with them to an audition, but they've never worked with them themselves. They don't know if they're easy to work with or hard to work with. And so an audition is a really important part of the process, where we get to see these people, and then a callback where we call the actors that we're really thinking seriously about for a certain roles back to see how they work together. In some configuration of what the cast might be, right? They also work with the design team. They may even assemble the design team to create the other elements of the production with the use of a unifying vision. So somebody like the lighting designer, the set designer, the costume designer, the prop master or mistress, the sound designer, right? All of these people are going to be brought together to create the kind of unified vision of this piece. Depending on where you're working at, those people may already be there. They may be in staff positions and you're going to work with them for the first time, or maybe they're people you've worked with lots of times before. And in some instances, you may be bringing in people or hiring people, some or all of the team. And in this instance, again, it's important to think about the personalities, people you've worked with before, people that you think understand the way you communicate and are able to kind of transform your ideas into tangible things for the stage, right? So those are all things you're thinking about too. They also rehearse the actors, right? They create a rehearsal schedule. They work with the actors to create not only the individual characters of the show, but develop the relationships of the piece, the pacing of the piece. That means kind of like the way the play moves, either quickly or slowly at times, creating the kind of overall arc of the show, building towards a moment of tension, working on, you know, the falling action of the piece. All of these things are really important, and that all gets worked out in rehearsal with the director. They also coordinate all other elements of production to the very first performance. So that could be any number of things. That can be, you know, press releases or publicity. It can be, you know, costume fittings and all number of things. And it really just depends. In some theaters, you have stage managers or production managers that are very much on top of that, and they help to coordinate all those things for you. And in some instances, you are kind of like the last person, you're the point person, you're where the buck stops, and you're the person doing all of that. So a lot of jobs, as someone said before. So in order to do all of these things, what are the skills that the director needs in order to be successful? You know, I think I started off this whole segment by saying that a director is a jack of all trades. It is really, really true. In order to be a good director, I think you need to know a little bit about everything, but especially the specific jobs the specific design jobs that go into creating a piece of theater. So it's really helpful if you can know something about set design. It's really helpful if you can know something about lighting and light design. It's really helpful if you can know something about costume design and costume history. And it's really, really important that you know about acting and how actors approach acting and how actors access the things that they need to. So, and that's just the beginning, right? So in order to talk with your lighting designer about what you want, for or to even begin envisioning what you want, it's really important that you know about how lights work on the stage. And what are the names for certain things? You know, what are the names for the specific kinds of instruments and what those instruments do for the stage? An instrument, the word instrument, when we use that for lighting, it means a lighting instrument. It means an actual light, right? We don't refer to them as lights or lamps. Sometimes we say lamps, but they're referred to as an instrument, a lighting instrument. And there are lots of different kinds of lighting instruments. You know, there are big lighting instruments and smaller lighting instruments and instruments that can throw a lot of light and wash the stage with color and instruments that can do more focused lights. There are instruments now that we have that can make light move, that can create moving gobos or patterns on the floor. And again, all of these words are words and things that as a director you need to know, because otherwise, like when I'm sitting down with my lighting director and I need to ask for something, it's really useful to be able to speak in the language that my lighting director understands and says, well, really what I want here is a special for this particular actor downstage right. I want it to be a very tight pool of light. I want it to be hot or bright. I want it to, you know, feel isolating, and I would like it to eventually move out into some other look, right? And all those words that, you know, I just used may be foreign to you, but those words are really important. It's a really important set of jargon that is useful when speaking to your designers. Because otherwise, it's kind of like speaking two different languages and trying to then like make sure that the translations are correct. So, you know, knowing these things are really important. That goes not just for lighting, but for, like I said, for sound design, for costume design, or for anything. So if any of you are ever interested in doing this, this job or becoming a director, really the biggest advice that I can give to anybody is do all the jobs. That's the best thing you can do to prepare for being a director first, is to do all the jobs. You need to have an understanding of how those jobs are done in order to communicate correctly to your designers. You need to understand what it means to design costumes for a show. You need to understand what it means to at least help design a set, to help design lights, and you need to have a functioning set of language that goes with all of those things that you can really communicate these ideas to your designers as you're working. What does that also entail? It entails human relations, right? It entails an ability to be able to communicate with people effectively, to, you know, in my opinion, the best directors are slow to anger, right? Slow to frustration. There are going to be a million times during the course of a show that are going to give you opportunity to panic or be frustrated or be upset. And it's really important that you have patience and that you control those things, because trust me that everything in the end always works out. But you have to be able to communicate well with others and be understanding of other people and different styles of communication that exist out there. Because trust me, in the course of working in the theater, with all the actors and all the designers that you'll work with, you will see that there is such a myriad of ways that people communicate, and being able to communicate well with each one of them is a really important part of being able to direct well. Decision making. Again, 100 types of decisions that you will have to make, and you need to be able to be decisive about things and sometimes be able to pick something and then change your mind about it later if you think that that's the right course. But to be able to be decisive about things is really important, to have a specific idea about what you want, and to be something that isn't here is to be detail oriented, because there are so many details that go into making a production. So the more detail oriented you are already up front, the better you're going to have a handle of what actually needs to take place, and nothing's going to slip through the cracks. There are, of course, a lot of managerial duties in terms of creating schedules and creating contact sheets and communicating with people, making sure that people are doing their jobs correctly, making sure that people are on task and that things are getting done at the right time. It is in some ways like being a boss, but a very collaborative boss, right? That's another thing, is that collaboration, the ability to be collaborative, is really, really important for a director. You can't walk into a show with a vision that's so narrow and so concrete that it isn't willing to be grown or to change in some way over the course of the production. Because you have to keep in mind that in the world of the theater, theater is collaboration. You're going to work with a bunch of actors that are going to approach their roles in a way that maybe isn't the way you imagined it. You're going to work with a bunch of designers who each have a particular approach to their design work that may not be precisely how you envisioned it. But what's really important and what can be wonderful about working in the theater is that when you're open to these collaborative partnerships, that something better than you imagined can come out, right? Because it wasn't just from your head. It was like your best ideas mixed with the costume designer's best ideas, mixed with the actor's best ideas. And when we put everybody's best ideas together, then of course we get something that is really wonderful at the end. And so, you know, I think directors that are not too dictatorial, but that are very open to, you know, being other people's creative process, other people's artistic ideas, these are the people that really end up with some of the best productions and some of the most unique pieces of art. And of course, creative. A director must be creative. A director must have a creative vision. They must be able to think creatively, to have unique ideas, and to be able to synthesize things in ways that maybe haven't ever been done before. And to be able to synthesize ways in ways that maybe have been done before, but maybe with a personal mark on it. So these are all skills that the director needs to have in order to be successful. So of course, what are the creative skills that the director needs? And how does he or she use them? Well, script selection is really important. We're thinking creatively in terms of what are the best pieces of writing out there? What are the best pieces of textual art that are out there? And in the process, we're thinking about our audience, we're thinking about the budget, the type of talent that you have available to you, what you personally like, and how are you gonna, what kind of master metaphor or directorial concept are you going to pull out of this piece? How can you take this piece and kind of elevate it to another level through your own vision and through some sort of unifying force. Of course, in the analysis of the script, that's a creative process, looking at the script for its major plot points, for relationships, for pacing, for time period and themes. This is a creative approach to the text, not just analytical, but also interpreting it in a creative way that can be theatrically presented on the stage, right? Not just an essay that we're going to write about this play at the end. We have to be able to creatively present this on the stage. Also, in their design oversight and inspiration, they're there, and this is really how I see the director, to inspire the designers by their concept, you know? My job isn't to tell the designer, I want these costumes to look exactly like here's the pictures, just do that. My job is to inspire the costume designer, the lighting designer, the set designer, to kind of see what I see and then create their own piece of art out of that. And that's really an important part, is making sure that, like, we're on the same page as artists, but at the same time, you are also artistically free to interpret this through your own perception and artistic skills. And obviously, there to coach the actors and to make sure that they get the best performances out of the actors and to stage the play in this very pictorial way, right? Some of the managerial skills that the director needs is scheduling skills, recording the original blocking and creating the original blocking, creating a contact sheet, publicity, and fundraising. So we're going to move on now to looking at two different directors here. We have about 17 minutes left, so I think we've got enough time here to look at these. The two directors that we're going to look at today are one you may have heard of, one you may not have heard of. So Julie Taymor is the first one we're going to look at. She's a really important female director. She was greatly influenced by Asian forms, mask work, and puppetry. She actually studied in Indonesia and Asia for part of her master work. She's very theatrical in her approach to the theater, and she's most well known for The Lion King, where she won the Tony Award for being the director of a musical. She was the first woman to win that award, which is quite astounding. She is always taking things in very abstract, unique ways, and we see her influences and her unique vision in everything that she touches. We're gonna look at a quick interview with her and her talking about her approach to her work. And then we're also gonna look at a little clip of a trailer to one of her newest works where she reinterpreted Midsummer Night's Dream, another show, right, that Peter Brook did, and get to see her beautiful art on stage and how she creates these visions. So let's look at this interview with Julie Taymor. Hopefully.
And don't take risks. I find that boring in life. What I loved about my upbringing was that the dinner table was constant conversation about...
That's okay. Anyways, Julie talks a lot about her approach to the theater there and the way that she looks at art and her influences and how that has specifically impacted the type of work that she does. And you saw there in the beginning how she's talking about risk-taking, and she's a huge risk-taker. She's done so many things on the stage and mixed things, synthesized things in ways that had never been done before. I think you're going to look at this next clip of... We don't need to try again with it. We're going to look at this next clip of Midsummer Night's Dream, and you're going to see some of those things in action. Her really unique vision on this play that's been around for hundreds of years, but never done quite in this way. Let's look at this trailer of Julie Taymor's take on A Midsummer Night's Dream.
Fetch me the flower!
What the juice of it? On sleeping eyelids lay.
will make all man or madly dote upon the next live creature that it sees.
Of this, I'll streak her eyes and make her full of hateful fantasies.
I pray thee, gentle mortal, I love thee.
What visions have I seen? Methought I was enamored of an ass.
There lies your love.
Wow, right? You've never seen a Midsummer Night's Dream like this. Amazing, the work that she does. And you can see in there the kind of influence of puppetry, of mask making. And here she is including projection, which is reminiscent of kind of like the shadow puppet play of Indonesia and Thailand. All these elements that she combines together in this way, you know, individually, maybe you've seen these things separately before, but when she puts them together in the way that she does, it's just fantastic. An amazing piece and one that is just so uniquely her that, again, as with any auteur director, you're looking at it and it just couldn't be anybody else but Julie Taymor's work. Another really fascinating director who's come onto the scene in the last few years is Ivan Vanov, and he is a Belgian director who's known for his avant-garde off-Broadway productions. His most recent one was actually The Crucible that he did, and he also did the thing that kind of got him a lot of acclaim was A View from the Bridge, which is by Arthur Miller. We have a couple clips here that is going to kind of introduce you to the View from a Bridge production that he did. And I think you're going to kind of see how he's taken this work and really transformed it through his own vision into something that is very different and new and fresh and captivating. So the first clip that we have is actually a clip of the Tony Awards production of his A View from the Bridge cast doing a short scene that I think really gives you an idea of the way this piece was performed. And then we'll take another look at the same show, but with looking at some of the actors and the production elements. But let's take a look here first at this scene, which was from the Tony Awards, which is Ivan Vanov's View from the Bridge.
I worked like a dog 20 years so a punk could have, so that's what I've done. I mean, in the worst times, you know? The worst, when there was no ships coming in the harbor, I didn't stand around looking for relief. I hustled. When there was empty piers in Brooklyn, I went to Hoboken and Staten Island, the West Side, Jersey, all over, because I made a promise. I took out of my own mouth to give to her. I took out of my wife's mouth. I walked hungry. Plenty days in the city, and now? I gotta sit in my own house and look at a son of a bitch punk like that. When she came out of nowhere, I'd give him my house to sleep. I'd take the blankets off my bed for him, and he takes and puts his dirty, filthy hands on her like a goddamn thief.
But Eddie, she's a woman now.
He's stealing from me.
But she wants to get married, Eddie. She can't marry you, can she?
What the hell are you talking about? I don't know what you're talking about.
I gave you my advice, Eddie. That's it.
So, for those of you that might not be familiar with the original piece, Arthur Miller wrote A View from the Bridge, which is one of his more well-written pieces, along with, you know, goodness, so many of the other things that he's written. But it is a beautiful piece, and it's really a middle-class drama. And yet here, Ivan kind of reimagines this whole entire tale. It's not taking place in a middle-class home or in middle-class settings like you would normally see this play, and people dressed in clothes that are appropriate to the era and the time, you know, the 50s. He sort of removes the entire thing and sets it in this very minimalist, almost no man's land that is almost like a blank canvas. And the actors wear these very nondescript pieces of clothing, and the light that is, even, goodness, you see it even in that clip, is all really very directional. It's coming from a really specific, there's no washes, right? And a lot of it is from above, straight down. And so what that feeling that creates on the stage is this sort of, it creates deep shadows a lot of times, so you have to make sure you balance that, which I think they did. But it creates this really, this world of a lot of deep, high contrast, right? You get a lot of shadows on the stage, you get some shadows on the actors' faces, and it's really, really sharp. The look is hard. It's not warm and soft or anything like that. And part of what that does is it forces us to focus not on what the actors are wearing or the set pieces or what's around them, but just on what they're saying and what they're thinking and what they're doing, right? And so it becomes this kind of like really highly focused piece on these characters alone and what they're experiencing and what they're saying. So it's not a surprise that he chose one of Arthur Miller's most well-written pieces to do that with. I think you're gonna take a look at this next clip, and we get a little bit of more explanation, and we see a little bit more of what this play looked like on Broadway, and get an even fuller feeling of how Van Ove's reinterpretation of the script really works and serves to really revive this piece and really modernize it. So we're gonna take a look here. This is a clip from Spotlight on Broadway.
A View from the Bridge is a classic Arthur Miller play, but this is like you've never seen it before. It's directed by avant-garde director Ivo van Hove, and there are very few props. There are almost no real costumes evoking the time period, which is the 1950s. The set is very spare and stark. It just elevates the whole thing to a true Greek-style tragedy, even though it takes place in Red Hook, Brooklyn. A View from the Bridge is one of the most well-written Arthur Miller plays, and that's saying a lot because his plays are so well-written. The story is captivating, the characters are very well-drawn, and this is just such a different production that you really hear the text. You're not going to a classic Arthur Miller play where they're dressed in period costumes and you can see the Brooklyn townhouse that they live in. You are in a very spare space. This sounds kind of crazy, but it feels like it's happening like in your psyche. It feels like it's happening almost in a dream state, which makes you just feel it on a really deep emotional level.
First of all, it's an amazing play. I mean, it's incredibly well constructed. The writing is extraordinary. The characters are just so wonderful. It's epic. I mean, the tiny microcosm of this family in this tiny house are experiencing massive human emotions.
The end of this show is so unexpected and so graphic and stark and just deep and emotional that you're just in a state of shock. You will walk out of this show talking about it for the rest of the evening, 100%.
Good. So I think that gives you a sense of kind of, and some of those production shots that you saw of really how Van Ove's, you know, reimagination of this play fits within his interpretation and his worldview. But also what I want to point out is that even though he kind of has this, what might be considered a kind of radical reinterpretation, right, kind of like stripping the play down to its very, very basic elements with, you know, kind of removing all of the signifying elements of the space and the signifying elements of the costume, those elements of design that might put us in a particular time or space and might be distracting in a certain way, how those things refocus us on the text and on the plot and on the kind of human emotions that are being expressed here and felt by this family. And even though that's really different and the play has never been done like this before, it still fits within the realm of theme that Arthur Miller originally intended, right? Like, he's not taking the play and putting it on Mars, right? Everyone's like walking around like space aliens or something, which would be kind of like radically outside of what the playwright intended. But he's simply asking us to look at it through a different lens. And because he is the director, he can choose the lens that he wants us to see it through. And in his vision, he wants us to see it through this very spare lens that kind of draws all of our attention to one aspect of the play. And I would venture to say that's probably the aspect of the play that he thought was most important, right? And he tried to think of a way, how can I get everybody to focus not on all these other things about this play, but on the language, on what these people are saying to each other, on what, how these people feel towards one another, the relationships, all of those things that are happening, not what they're wearing. Because what they're feeling and what they're experiencing has a universal, timeless quality, right? So again, we see how the director's concept and his or her approach to the piece can suddenly shift the entire play from a place that has lived forever into a completely new and exciting sphere. Vanova just actually, his newest production that he just did was Arthur Miller's The Crucible. And we all know that, again, is another period piece that is written, it's an allegory about the Red Scare and McCarthyism, but it's written to take place in, you know, 16th century, you know, America and the Salem witch trials. And typically you see that show done in people wearing, you know, pilgrim costumes and bonnets and all this stuff. And he, again, took the piece out of that world and transplanted it into a kind of stark school setting, right? Where all the girls instead were not girls in this kind of cloistered town in New England, but were rather these kind of girls cloistered in a school, right? So they're all wearing school uniforms, and there's a chalkboard because they're in a classroom a lot of times. And the grown-ups around them aren't really they're elders and authorities, but they're elders and authorities in this new setting. So even though he hasn't changed any of the language, by simply taking the script and putting it in a place that he feels maybe helps us to understand the themes in a way that is more timeless or more relevant to us in somehow, again, he transforms the piece into something that is something we haven't seen before and maybe we can relate to in a way that we haven't before. So hopefully, I hope what you have seen through all of these, this kind of comparison of some really new directors that are doing different things, is that there's so much that directors can do with what they have, and the sky is really the limit. There's so much synthesis and mixing of things that we can do, and it's really an exciting time in the theater to have all these tools at our disposal, yet the director's job in today's world is highly important and really something that the modern theater needs and continues to need. Well, guys, that brings us to the end of our last and final broadcast. I want to remind you to please go online, take your final exam by Sunday. If you have any late work you need to turn in, please contact me, discuss it with me. We can try to work something out. And your discussion board is also due by Sunday, the 14th at midnight. Thank you so much for being with me over the last 15 weeks. I appreciate it. I hope you learned a lot, and I hope you have a great summer. Goodbye.